Hello,
Hi.
it's lovely to meet you. Who are you?
I'm Simon Anholt, and I run something called the Good Country, which is a project that's designed to encourage countries to collaborate more and compete a tiny bit less. And I've been doing that for the last several years, and before that, I was a government advisor. I spent my time rushing around the planet, helping the governments of a large number of countries to engage more effectively with other countries. So, helping the world to work together has been the theme of my life for the past 20 years or so.
I'd love to know how Good Country works. How is it structured, and how can we all participate?
Well, the Good Country isn't really a thing yet. It's basically an idea. What it is my It's my super simple analysis of what's gone wrong with the world and how we can fix it, which I've managed to get down after 30 years. I've managed to boil it down to a 2-minute animation, which is on the front page of the website, which basically says, here's what's wrong, here's what we need to do. And the Good Country is really just the elaboration of that super simple analysis and that super simple proposition. Within it, there are a couple of, well, they're the first two projects that have come out of it. The first one is a thing called the Good Country Index, which is basically a compilation of an enormous amount of data on how countries behave. And we've combined all of that data in order to give a ranking of how much each country on Earth contributes to the common good of humanity and to the planet, which is a very unusual way of measuring countries. There are hundreds of studies out there that measure how well countries perform in terms of their productivity or their GDP or their transparency or their competitiveness, but they all look inwards and measure countries' behavior as if they were entirely separate from each other. But of course, in the modern world, they're not. So the Good Country Index is the only one, as far as I'm aware, that actually looks at countries as part of a complete system, as part of the one planet which they're all located in, and says, what do they give to the common good of humanity, and what do they take away? So that's the first project. And then the second project is a thing called the Global Vote, which is a provocation, if you like. It's a platform which enables anybody, anywhere in the world, to have a vote in the elections of other countries. And it's there for exactly the same reason. It's to try to encourage people to understand how interconnected and interdependent all countries are. Any country, even a tiny country that we've never heard of on the other side of the world, if they elect the right leader, that's going to benefit everybody in the world because we're so connected in the age of globalization. And if they elect the wrong leader, that could do an enormous amount of harm to people outside the borders of that country as well as inside. And that project is going really well. We had an enormous number of people from 130 countries voting on the US election. We've just done the Dutch election. We're in the middle of doing the French election. We've got the German and Iranian elections coming up. And generally speaking, we cover about one of those every month.
Could I take you back to indexing of countries? I'm interested in the categories. Could you take us through the categories?
Sure, if I can remember them. The way, interestingly enough, the design of the Good Country Index actually didn't start with the categories. It started with a wish list. So whenever you do a big international study of this sort, and I've been doing them for quite a few years, you ask yourself, first of all, what is it I want to measure? Right. And I knew what I wanted to measure. I wanted to measure the contribution of countries to the whole of humanity. Because I was sick to death of countries going around bragging about how much money they made for their own citizens and their own businesses. And I thought, that's just not the way of doing it. So the next question was, how would we do that? Well, I don't want to measure people's perceptions because they're very unpredictable. I want to measure reality. And so I sat down with my colleague Robert Govers, and we started making a long, long list of all of the indicators we could think of, the reliable, robust, proper measurements that measure pretty much every country on Earth and measure some tangible impact that that country has. So, for example, how many people do they kill around the world outside their own borders every year in international conflicts? Yes. That's obviously a negative indication.
Yes, yes.
Call me old-fashioned, but I think killing people is wrong. On the good side, how many volunteers do they send out to go out from that country to voluntary international organizations every year? How much do they help stimulate the international cultural discourse? What are all the good things they do for humanity, and what are all the bad things? And the idea was that we would then create a balance sheet, and we'd say they do this much bad stuff, they do this much good stuff. On balance, you can feel glad that this country exists because they give more than they take to humanity, mm-hmm. or vice versa. Having then found all of the data sets, there really weren't very many, because measuring robustly, regularly, every year, the behaviors of at least 125 countries, which was the number we first started with in the first edition of the Good Country Index back in 2014. There are only about 35 pieces of research that do that properly. And they're almost all conducted by the big international organizations, the United Nations system, the Bretton Woods institutions, the World Bank, and so on and so forth, because nobody else has got the resources to carry out that kind of measurement regularly and reliably. We ended up with 35 data sets and started trying to sort them into some kind of category, because 35 is a lot of data sets to get your head around. And we realized that actually they fell into a very similar set of categories as are laid out in the United Nations Declaration about what are the benefits to humanity from humanity. So there's one which is about peace and security. How much does your country contribute to international peace and security, not domestically, because that's measured in so many other surveys, there's no point in me doing that again. Mm-hmm. There are things like health and well-being. Mm-hmm. How much does your country contribute to the health and well-being of the people who are not your citizens? And there are things like knowledge and learning. How much does your country contribute to the global store of knowledge and learning and culture?
Science and technology.
Science and technology are rather a sort of next door one,
yes,
to that.
Yeah.
Climate and planet. Mm-hmm. How much does your country contribute to the shared environment, to the atmosphere, and to the cleanliness of the oceans and the rivers and all the rest of it? And there are seven of those. So it just worked out quite neatly that those 35 indicators fit more or less properly into those seven categories. The other one, by the way, is world order, which is a sort of general one, mm-hmm. about how much the country contributes to the international system. Do they pay their dues to the UN agencies? Are they a helpful collaborative player, or are they sulky kid who sits in the corner?
Number of immigrants that they take in, I think, is included within that section, isn't it?
Yes, there are several. There are two data sets about migration. One is about how many foreign migrants you welcome, mm-hmm. because you're obviously helping to resolve a major global problem if you mm-hmm. do that, and also how many refugees leave your country, because if you're doing that as a country, then you're contributing mm-hmm. to a challenge for the international community, which may not be your fault. And it's very important to understand that the purpose of this index is not to blame anybody for anything. Mm-hmm. A couple of people, The Economist published an article about the study when it first appeared, and they characterized the top 10 countries as the good countries and the bottom 10 as the bad countries. But that's not the idea at all. The fact that a country like China, for example, ranks very near the bottom of the index, that's not me saying, bad China, you must do more. That's me simply observing that China, for very understandable reasons, up until this point in history, has been focusing very hard on its own population and its own challenges, mm-hmm. because they're both gigantic. And you could well argue, and I do argue, that if China is trying to raise the standard of living of 1.2 billion Chinese people, then that's a pretty significant proportion of the world's population anyway. So I'm not chastising them. I'm not questioning people's motivations for doing things, and I'm not laying blame for the bad things. All I'm doing is saying, look at the world this way, mm-hmm. and see how it makes you think. If we do it as a balance sheet and we ask about a country's contribution to the global commons instead of their success, mm-hmm. then that's a different way of looking at the world, and arguably a really useful one.
Can we look at Sweden's ranking versus the US's ranking? Without wishing to put you on the spot, can you maybe pull a few examples out of the hat to compare both and why Sweden ranks as one and number one and the US as number 20? Again, I know that you're not apportioning blame or making any judgments here, but an interesting comparison nonetheless.
Absolutely an interesting comparison. Well, a few things to say. First of all, to look at the overall ranking, the absolute ranking in the entire index, it's interesting, but it doesn't tell you the whole story, of course, because there are seven categories hidden in that overall first ranking. So that's just the average over the whole mm-hmm. seven categories. And each one of those categories is the average of five individual data sets. So to really understand why Sweden or America or anywhere else ranks where it does, you really do need to look at the detail. And it may well be that a country ranks quite low because it's got a catastrophically poor result on one or two indicators, not because it's low all the way through. So that's the first thing to say. The second thing to say is that because there are 163 countries in the latest edition of the index, that's an awful lot of countries and an awful lot of entries. So, and they have to be ranked because it's a ranking. And so the difference between first place and 20th place is really not enormous. There just happen to be 18 other countries that happen to fit in between those two. But that's the top cluster. So the thing that I find myself reassuring Americans of on a very regular basis is that if you come into the top 20, there's no point in worrying about whether you're 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, or 21 to 25. You are one of the countries that net-net, relative to the size of your economy, gives quite a lot to the rest of the world, or does quite a lot of good and relatively little harm. Now, to me, 20th place for the United States, considering how multiple and absolute and gigantic its engagements are around the world, that's an extraordinarily high position. Because to be as engaged globally as the United States is in terms of trade, diplomacy, war, politics, society, culture, and still be in the top 20 is a pretty remarkable achievement, because normally the more engaged you are, the more opportunities you have to do good and ill. Mm-hmm. Having said all that, it's also important to bear in mind that most of the indicators, we normalize them, to use the technical term, we divide them by GDP. We tried all kinds of other ways of doing this, but it turned out that GDP was the most sensible way of doing it. And the reason for doing that is to create a level playing field, because otherwise all the biggest, richest countries would just be at the top, and the poorest, weakest countries would be at the bottom, and that wouldn't tell us anything. So I'm interested in knowing what countries contribute as a proportion of what they've got to contribute. And that, of course, slightly helps the smaller countries. Although the fascinating thing is that if you take away that normalization, America ranks even lower than 20th. So it's probably better for the self-respect of the Americans not to take away that particular operation. But the simple fact of the matter is that Sweden, on average, on balance, just has a healthier balance sheet towards the rest of the world. It does more good and slightly less harm. America does slightly less good and slightly more harm, but they're both in the top.
Can you tell us about the global vote, how it works, and your objectives in making it one of the tools of the Global Country Initiative?
I think the idea first came to me probably when Barack Obama was first elected as President of the United States, and I read all over the media, as everybody in Europe did, about how enormously popular he was around the world. And somebody or other, some newspaper said, jokingly, well, if this had been an international vote, then he would sail into the White House. And I found myself thinking about that, and I thought, what an interesting idea. Of course, it isn't an international vote. And you could easily enough make it one, but why would you? Is it right that somebody in Germany should be able to vote for the next American president? And of course the Americans wouldn't like that one bit, because they would assume that they don't share the same interests as a German voter. And of course it would only be fair to do that if the Americans also had a chance to vote in the German election. And the more I thought about this, the more it started to appeal to me, because of course it fits exactly with the principle of interdependence that the good country is based on. Whether or not you approve or disapprove of globalization, and by the way, that's a subject that I'm sure we're going to get onto later because that's at the heart of all of this. Whether or not you approve or disapprove of it, the fact of the matter is that we live in a highly globalized world. We are hyper-connected as countries, and therefore every decision taken in every country potentially can and often does has an impact on the lives of people in other countries. And it began to occur to me that there was something quite unfair about this, because what is a national election? Well, therefore, a national election is a relatively small number of people having the right to vote on a decision which could affect the lives of a very large number of people, and that doesn't feel very democratic. And of course, the perfect example is Brexit. Okay, it's not an election, it's a referendum, but it's the same principle. You've got a relatively small number of British adults who are voting on a decision which is going to directly affect the lives and livelihoods not merely of the entire population of the United Kingdom, but the entire population of the European Union and beyond. And it suddenly struck me that that being the case, it's actually, if you think about it objectively, quite unfair. And wouldn't it be interesting to know how different the result would be if the people who have to suffer the consequences of this decision were also able to vote? And so that's what it is. It's an experiment to find out what that feels like. It's not a proposal that this is how elections should be run in the future, because I couldn't see how it could possibly work, and it would cause so much unhappiness and fury. I mean, the global vote, even though it's only, if you like, symbolic, it's only virtual, has already caused an enormous amount of unhappiness, as well as a great deal of jubilation in other quarters. And I'm going to carry on doing it because it's fascinating, and because apart from anything else, I think a lot of people appreciate the global vote because it's one source of completely neutral, completely factual, completely unbiased information about the candidates. So if you look at the website, the way that we do it is that every time we cover an election, there's a very short, very simple, very succinct candidate profile for each of the official candidates in the election. And I tie myself in knots to make those profiles absolutely scrupulously neutral and objective. I don't make any commentary at all. And the only subject that we deal with is that candidate's position on international affairs. In fact, what I do is I ask them, I send every candidate two questions for which I request a personal answer. The first question is, if you become the next president of your country, what are you going to do for the rest of us, the remainder of the 7 billion who are not your voters? And the second question is, what is your vision of your country's role in the world? Some of them answer. It's not every candidate in every election, and sometimes I wish more would, but the number's gradually increasing. We get two or three in every election, and the number seems to be going up. What's interesting is that I actually get quite a lot of emails now from politicians in countries whose elections I'm not yet covering, saying, when we have our election, please will you cover it, and please can I give you the answer to those two questions. So it's already beginning to work. I guess that in the longer term, what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to help politicians and the media and citizens around the world to understand the international implications of what we have traditionally regarded as a purely domestic issue. Any country, even the tiniest country on earth, could produce the next Mandela or the next Stalin. There's no longer a very clear distinction between domestic and international politics. And so we're all involved in one way or another. Do I think it would be right for people in a distant country to actually have a vote that carries executive power in a domestic election in another country? Frankly, no. I just think that that's probably more trouble than it's worth. But do I think those politicians should be interested in what people around the world think? Yes, I do. And so in a sense, what this is an exercise for enabling politicians and citizens and the media to be confronted with this question, so that gradually the international dimension of every domestic political decision will start to become a familiar notion. and it will hang in the air. And even if I'm not there asking those particular candidates, what is your view for your country's role in the world, that question will be asking itself. And people will be saying, why is nobody answering that question? Why are they only talking about domestic issues? If you become the head of state or the head of government of your country, as I told Theresa May in a tweet the other week, you become part of the team that runs the planet, whether you like it or not. So the Prime Minister of Great Britain can pretend all she likes that her only responsibility is to her own voters and her own corporations. But the simple fact of the matter is that she's joined the team that runs the planet. And therefore she has a responsibility for everybody else to some extent. And her skill, any politician's skill as a national leader, consists in their ability to harmonize those two frequently but not invariably conflicting mandates. The challenge for any leader in the future, and this is what the good country is all about, is can you reconcile your obligations towards your own people and to every man, woman, child and animal on the planet? Can you reconcile your responsibility for your own slice of territory with your responsibility for the whole of the Earth's surface and the atmosphere above it? That for me is the gold standard of good governance in the 21st century, that you can do both. And the big secret is that it's not a sacrifice. You don't have to sacrifice one for the other. You don't have to do bad things for your own people if you want to do good things for the world. You don't have to make your own people starve if you want to stop other people starving. You don't have to punish the entire climate if you want to grow economically. As a matter of fact, quite the contrary. And I'm very lucky because for the last 20 years, my job has been advising real governments around the world on real issues. And what I've discovered is that there is a new way of doing governance. You don't see it very often, but there is a new way of doing it where you harmonize those two needs. You do inside and outside at the same time, and it makes better policy. That's the fantastic thing. It's not 2 plus 2 equals 4. It's 2 plus 2 equals 22.
What are the common misconceptions about what you are trying to do?
The most common misconception of all, and people often get this if they just read the title or watch the first few moments of one of my TED Talks, which is a very common habit these days, is that I'm somehow militating for one world government. That for me, the ultimate aim of all of this is to have one government, perhaps in the United Nations headquarters running the world. Let me state very categorically that I think that's the worst idea in the world. I mentioned a moment ago that my job is a government advisor, and I've seen enough about how countries are run to understand that good government is good in proportion to its closeness to the daily needs and aspirations of the people that it's trying to govern. So the best kind of government I've ever seen has been local government at the level of towns, municipalities. The worst government I've ever seen is national, federal government of very, very large countries. I advised the last president of Mexico, Felipe Calderón, for a number of years. As a country with a 120 million population, like the United States, it has a federal system to try to give some kind of local responsibility on a state level. But those kinds of gigantic populations are, let's be honest, ungovernable. That's too large a group of people for you to be able to govern them effectively or sensitively. Lord knows Calderón and his successor and his predecessors have all done their very best to try, but in reality, it doesn't work. It's too many people. So for me, the idea of somebody sitting in New York or wherever it might be, passing laws that will affect the daily lives of somebody sitting in Kathmandu or Lima, it's the worst idea in the world. So I am definitely not for one world government.
I have a question from Larry Sanger, co-founder of Wikipedia. Where do you place yourself on the political spectrum?
I prefer not to be on the political spectrum at all. As far as I can recall, I've only ever voted once in my life in a domestic election in the UK, where I'm a citizen. And the reason for that is because, like so many people these days, I buy tracks, I don't buy albums. And the idea of having to brand yourself as left-wing or right-wing and buy into a whole slew of policies of which you might well disagree with more than half, just because you want to affiliate yourself with some kind of pseudo-tribal affiliation and say, I'm working class, or I'm labor, and or I'm capital, or I'm what have you. It just seems to me like a stupid, childish joke. I reject tribalism in all of its forms. I think this is a kind of pathology, that you have to belong to a party or buy into an ideology. I look at the policies made by my own government here in the UK. I disagree with probably three quarters of them, and of the remaining quarter, there is no absolute majority of any individual party or ideology that produces the good ones. So for me to affiliate myself with a party would be just nonsense. I have, in my own background and my own history, I have as many reasons to consider myself as being left-leaning as I have to consider myself right-leaning. And if the good country is to work at all, it has to appeal to people on both sides of this pretend spectrum of left versus right versus center. And one of the things that I'm very proud of is the fact that if you look at the membership database of the people who've signed up to the Good Country so far, I know from the emails I get from them, my job these days is just answering emails, that's all I ever do, I know that there are quite a large number of them who you would define as right-wing, very conservative, even nationalistic, which is quite surprising considering what the Good Country stands for. And probably a slightly larger number, but by no means the overwhelming majority, are on the other side. So what I'm talking about is making the world work better. And whether you're left-wing, right-wing, or center, it should make no difference. You still want to make the world work better, because the last time I checked, every single country and every single political party inhabited the same planet. So we have a clear common interest here, and that's what I'm interested in identifying.
The second part of the question from Larry Sanger is, how do you propose to make this all work? I mean, you're raising the debate about international, the need for international democracy, the need for individual countries to take international issues seriously, to work together, to collaborate. How will this actually work? How are you going to make this work? Larry Sanger would like to know.
Well, the way that I'm going to make it work is by bringing together as many of the people and groups and organizations as I can to do their own thing under the same basic banner. No, banner is the wrong word. I don't want to oblige people to call what they're doing good country or good anything. As I said before, the good country is an idea. It's an idea which I hope, this is my little vanity, I hope that it's as important an idea as feminism or environmentalism, and as necessary. And indeed my hope, if you like, my vision for the future, is that I, with the help of many, many other people and organizations, will succeed in making nationalism as obsolete and as taboo as racism and sexism have started to become today. So the idea that you belong first to a nation and second to the human race is a very damaging and very destructive idea, and I would like to reverse it. I don't disapprove of nations by any means. I think nations are a great idea. I love cultural difference. I'm an anthropologist by training. To me, the cultural differences between countries are one of the best things about being human. I love difference. I'm not trying to erase it. But what I am suggesting is that one's first loyalty should be to the human race and to the planet. And then one's second loyalty could be to one's country, but one's country, not one's nation. Loyalty to the nation is the same thing as having loyalty to an army and a president. It's not a nice thing. It's not a helpful thing. It's a piece of aggressive, hostile tribalism, which is one of the things that keeps us in the 19th, the 18th, and occasionally even the 17th century. So That's the overall aim. And the way to answer Larry's question that I want to do this is by doing what I've been doing for the last 4 years, which is reaching out to as many broadly like-minded people as I can identify all over the world and saying, do your own good country. There are so many people I've identified around the world. Actually, about 700 million, but it would take too long to go into the piece of research that led to that number. But about 10% of the world's population, it turns out, according to some research I've done, are what you might call natural committed cosmopolitans. They're the people who already see themselves as citizens of the world first, who think that that's much more exciting and much grander and much more fun and something to be really proud of. More so than being a citizen of their nation and holding a particular passport. That's important too, but it just comes lower in the list. Now, that's 700 million people, potentially the largest movement in the history of humanity. Somebody will correct me there, but it seems like a really big number. And so what I want those 700 million people to do, or some of them, is to come to me as they're doing at the moment and saying, I'd love to do this. I'd love to start a political party, right, that tries to encourage voters to think internationally. So I've had a group of political activists in Australia, for example, just the other week wrote to me and they said, we are quizzing the people who are standing for the next prime minister. Can we use the Good Country Index, those categories, to quiz them about what their policies are going to be? What are you going to do for health and education? What are you going to do for climate and planet? What are you going to do for this, that, and the other? This is the sort of thing that I'm trying to do. I've got, I had an email from a woman who teaches at a private university in Bangladesh saying that she's using the global vote as a teaching tool. So she picks a country that we're covering in one of the elections, she teaches her students about it, and then at the end of the class she gets them to vote. And they get really, really fired up because they're actually participating in the election, even though it's on the other side of the planet. And I've got lots of educationalists who are saying, can we use the global vote? Can we use the Good Country Index? I had an email just 2 days ago from a school in the UK, 6 to 10-year-olds, who looked at one of my TED Talks and discussed whether the global vote could work. And they can vote in the class. The lower age limit for voting in the global vote is currently 4, but I'm thinking of lowering it. It was actually quite interesting because a lot of politically active 4-year-olds out there, you'd be surprised. The US global vote, I deduced, although I don't collect demographic information about voters, but you can deduce from various things, an enormous number of the American citizens who voted on the US election in the global vote were teenagers. In other words, kids who were too young to be able to vote legally, but desperately wanted their voice to be heard, probably, possibly, because it was different from the way that their parents were voting. It's a long answer to a simple question. The good country should become a movement of movements. I want people all over the world to do their own thing that somehow at some level reflects the core idea, and that's the only way it's going to have as much impact as feminism or environmentalism or any of those other isms that there have been in the past. I don't want to start an NGO. I don't want to find myself in 5 years' time running some organization with dozens of people sitting at desks, all frantically trying to raise contributions from their members so they can carry on paying for the advertising campaigns to get more contributions.
There are four elections listed on your website as
upcoming
fairly,
ones, yeah.
fairly shortly. Serbia, yeah. First week of April. France, 23rd of April, Germany, Iran, 19th of May, Germany, 24th of September. Earlier you spoke about writing up the summaries of the candidates for yep. The global vote, and you said that you tried to make it as fair as possible, expressing no opinion whatsoever. I would think that it is sometimes difficult for you to be viewed that way. For example, by Iran, you know, you're a Westerner living in a Western country. promoting international democracy. I mean, one of the prerequisites for voting in Iran is, as you know, to be a follower of Islam. How do you get over that? Are there any plans maybe in the future of making that element of a good country more like a wiki, where people can come in and write up what they think, and then it's sort of...
That's a really, really interesting question. The last part of it, well, it's all an interesting question. The first thing to say is that I don't write the candidate profiles in every case now. In almost all cases, purely for workload reasons. The shameful thing I have to admit is that the good country is an evenings and weekends hobby for me at the moment. I still do my day job of flapping around the world advising foreign governments, speaking at conferences and so forth, and all the money I earn from that goes in to fund the good country. So we have no external funding, and therefore there's no we. I have two very close friends who help me give away far more of their spare time than they can really afford to do. But there's no office. There's no good country central. This is not, you know, a vase with a vast skyscraper full of researchers and billions of dollars worth of funding. And although it would be an enormous relief if somebody did come along and offer us billions of dollars, and a lot of things could get very better very quickly if we did, I do quite like the fact that it's unfunded, and therefore nobody can tell us what to write or how to write it or where to do it. The frustrating thing is the man and woman power. We can't cover every election every day, and by the way, we will also be covering the South Korean presidential election. They need a new president fairly shortly. We may even cover the Turkish constitutional referendum. I've had so many people ask me about that. I've actually got various reasons to treat that as a domestic-only issue. Mm-hmm. That's arguably nobody's business, but the business of the Turks. But it's an arguable point.
And you express that on the website, don't you?
Yes. In the FAQs. If I could wave a magic wand, I would have people taught at school what an FAQ is and why you should read it before you start emailing the person. I mean, I'm happy to answer people's emails, but quite honestly, you know, most of the time all I'm doing is giving them the link to the FAQ. Anyway, that's beside the point. Mm-hmm. So that's the first thing to say. The candidate profiles are first and foremost researched and the first draft written by somebody from that country, or at least in that country, who knows the political situation very, very well indeed. And then the second stage is an enormous amount of fact-checking. To make the thing readable to people, we don't have pages and pages and pages of footnotes and references, but my aim, and I think we usually achieve it, is that every statement, quotation, or assertion made about any individual candidate is backed up by reliable documentary evidence, which can be produced if required. So I don't want the thing to look like an academic paper, which is why we don't give all the references, but they are there. One of the things that I'm experimenting with at the moment in Serbia is partnering with a media outlet in that country. So this is something which is potentially very interesting to get local journalists or a local newspaper, TV channel, website or what have you, to help me develop the candidate profiles, because they're going to have better access to the candidates than I am, so we can get more personalized quotes. And more importantly, they can also get the word out to the local population and mm-hmm. say, by the way, your election is also being covered for the world, by the world, and to get them interested in participating. Because I love it when people in the country itself vote on the global vote as well. And when they start expressing an interest in what the world is thinking about their election. So working with local media is something, as I say, that I'm trialing at the moment. Making it wiki style, where people can contribute, I am very interested in that, like most people who have a job that involves any amount of research whatsoever, I use Wikipedia for hours and hours and hours every day. I doubt whether I'd be able to do this project without Wikipedia, quite honestly. Well, it would be a lot harder and a lot slower. So clearly there's something about Wikipedia that works, and there's clearly something about the information it carries that inspires trust, even in somebody as hard to please as me when it comes to trust. So that's a possibility, but I see that as being somewhere in the future. People get so heated about politics. This is part of the problem. I'm mystified by this, you see, because science, political science is my subject. I'd be the first person to admit that politics is actually quite boring. And, you know, it's a dull subject, let's be honest. So why do people get so excited about it? And one of the things that I've been pleading for recently is cool politics, cool-headed politics. Let's see if we can discuss these things in a rational way, without labeling each other, without getting overexcited about things, without getting hostile and aggressive, because you can't persuade anybody if that's the way that it's being done. And this is partly the responsibility of the many populist politicians around at the moment, because their aim, of course, the way that they achieve power, is by stirring people up to a level of hysteria. And that's what they want, and that's what, generally speaking, they succeed in achieving. And I would just beg people to understand that no matter how difficult your life may be, no matter how much politics, good politics or bad politics, may have affected your life, the only way you can find a political situation to your political problems is by being reasoned and courteous and rational about it, and of course speaking to people who have different opinions from you and not just the same opinions of you. There's a lot of things there that need fixing, and one of the things I'm hoping is that the good country, through its various projects, will be able to influence that that debate a little bit in the future.
I have a question from John Househill, who is the founder of Given Water, and his question very much relates to the individual, and he would like to know what are the challenges an individual is faced with in being a good person, and how do those things, those challenges, filter down into whether a country is a good country?
They're obviously intimately linked, because there's no way on earth that the good country is ever going to go anywhere unless people not only believe and understand, but are also able to enact their beliefs about how the world can be a better place at a personal level as well as at a national level. So let's be honest, thinking at this high level that we've been discussing up until now, at the level of nations, at the level of the entire planet, it makes your brain hurt. It certainly makes my brain hurt, and this is supposed to be my job. So I'm well aware of the fact that most people that I'm talking to, like me, find that fairly stress-inducing. And in the end, it's a great relief to go back to thinking about everyday things, smaller things, because smaller things paradoxically seem more important than bigger things. Paradoxically, because it's just an effect of optics. They're close up. And so they look, you know, that warning you get on the wing mirror of American-made cars that says, warning, objects in the mirror may be closer than they appear. That's the way things work. In reality, the big problems are the big problems, and the close-up problems are the small problems, but that's just the way the human mind works. So one of the things that I've been working hardest on, I spoke before about trying to make a movement of movements, is to talk to people who are working at a much more local level to see whether the basic mechanism of the good country can be articulated at that level. And the good news is it can. I've had some of the most exciting discussions I've had since starting this project when talking to people about what is a good university, what is a good school, what is a good company, right? Or even what is a good family. Any group of people, more than two people, they're going to be facing the same question that the good country asks. Is it possible to harmonize your own individual collective group needs with those of the wider society? And the answer is the same. Yes, it is. If you're really smart and you really know what you're doing, you can actually produce better results for your own people if you also consider the needs of everybody else. Climate change, I suppose, more than anything else, is beginning to teach us this, that we can save money at home by saving the planet. And that's, if you like, the classic example of how thinking internationally and locally at the same time. You know, one of the things I'd love to see one day is the role of the foreign minister in a government completely change. At the moment, the foreign minister is the bloke, and he's always a bloke, whose job it is to keep the foreigners out, right? And we only hear from him when there's war or trade sanctions being threatened. The rest of the time, you know, he's never seen. I would like the foreign minister's job to be turned completely inside out, and for him or her to be made responsible for opening the windows of the country and bringing in influence, inspiration, discussion, cooperation, collaboration with every damn country on earth, even at the most local level. I'd like to see the foreign minister in meetings about healthcare, about every single domestic issue, because the more you look at what other countries have done, could do, and are doing, the more you work with them, the more you collaborate and brainstorm with them, the better results you will get and they will get. It just works better. The more you stir up the gene pool, the more exciting the results. And if you go to the average government meeting in any country, it's a bunch of people, predominantly male in most countries, invariably from precisely the same cultural background. And it's not really surprising that they never produce anything very new, because who you are and where you come from determines to a terrifying degree what you're capable of inventing. And so they never invent anything. And they just recycle the same old ideas round and round and round and round. Now, if you were to open the windows in that dreadful conference room and you would let a few people jump in through the open window, somebody who's dealt with something completely different in a rather similar country, somebody who's dealt with something absolutely identical in a very different country, you would immediately start finding that a lot of your domestic problems appear in a completely different light, and you start dealing with them much more effectively. So, on the question of the articulation of the philosophy at the personal level, how can you be a good person is really a very different question from the question, how can you be a good country, good company, good village, good family, good university? Because that's more about personal morals. And I'm very, very careful not to get too much into morality, because that's tied up with religion and it's tied up with culture. And you start getting into a lot of fascinating debates, but fundamentally unproductive debates about what do I believe is good and what do I believe is not good. At the heart of the matter, however, there is this commonality. The moment you understand and experience for yourself how harmonizing your own interests with those of the people around you makes better results, you are becoming a better person, a better family, a better town, a better region, a better country, a better planet. Who knows, a better universe.
You are very passionate about this initiative. You're incredibly driven. This is, you've described it in terms of the time you give it as a hobby. Why do you do this? I mean, what are your personal motivations? And how does your human story relate to this?
The reason why I'm impoverishing myself and my family to do this, and the reason I spend far longer than I really should at my age on something of this sort, is because it makes sense. And that's the way my mind works. If I find something that makes sense, I have to see it through. And even though I've only been doing the good country for 3 years, maybe four if you take some of the roots of it into account, the reality of the matter is that I've really been working on this for most of my life. And a lot of the stuff that feeds into it, the belief about the value of culture and the greater value of intercultural mixing, well, I was writing about that stuff 20 years ago. And actually, if I think about what I was interested in back at school, I was doing it then too. So in a sense, now at age 56, what I'm bringing to this is everything I've ever believed in and boiled down into a single package. And I hope that what it's, the reason I've been able to do that is because I've been able to achieve a tiny measure of wisdom. And wisdom is about being simple again. You know, when you're an adolescent, if you're quite intelligent, what you tend to do is to become more and more and more complicated. And we always meet clever people, don't we, who stay like that for the rest of their lives, and they get more and more and more complicated until you can't understand a bloody word they're talking about. And that's because they've achieved brilliance, but they haven't achieved wisdom. Yeah. And wisdom is when you've learned an enormous amount through personal experience and reading and research and study, and then you start to learn how to make it as simple as a child all over again. And so you're talking like a child. The good country is child's talk. It's no accident that the two-minute animation illustrated by the brilliant Leo Antolini, who illustrates for children's books, that sounds childish. But the only difference between that and a child talking is that this is a 56-year-old talking, and it's backed up by the wisdom of the intervening 30, 40 years of experience, but distilled down into simplicity. So that's the reason I do it, because I know it's right, because I know it makes sense. And I'm a kind of intellectual, and if something makes sense to me, I can't let it go. I have to see it happen. And then it's also to do with the job that I was doing previously, because, as I say, and I still do it to some extent, flapping around the world advising foreign governments. And I'd have this experience over and over and over again, where I'd be sitting with government officials in country on the other side of the world, and we'd be talking about their aims and dreams and aspirations for that country and its role in the community of nations. Fascinating, fascinating conversations. And in effect, what I spent most of the first years of my career trying to do was to help them to be more competitive in trade, in diplomacy, in cultural relations, and all the rest of it. And then I'd get on the plane to fly back home, and I'd read the newspaper, and I'd see that, you know, the planet's on fire, and people are killing each other as usual, and everything's going horribly wrong. And I started thinking to myself, actually, I'm part of the problem. I'm not part of the solution. Because what I'm doing is I'm advising all of these governments how to shaft each other more effectively. And that's exactly what I shouldn't be doing. I should be spending much more time and much more effort on telling them how to collaborate more effectively. Because collaboration and competition can coexist. A lot of people seem to imagine that I think competition is a bad thing. I don't think competition is a bad thing. Competition is an essential thing. It's a fundamental part of human nature. It gives us sport. It gives us achievement. It's a great thing. It only becomes a problem when it's the only altar at which we worship. And the problem of the last 30 or 40 years, the reason why we've let globalization spin so madly out of control and cause so much inequality and poverty and suffering and injustice, is because we've worshipped exclusively at the altar of competitiveness. And we've forgotten, at the international level, cooperation and collaboration. Now, industry discovered back in the 1970s, Japanese industry, that you can do something called co-optition, which is where the competitors in a given marketplace actually cooperate. I'm not talking about illegal cartels here. I'm talking about sensible collaboration. Sensible. I'm the proud owner of a Tesla Model S. Okay, and very proud. And I brag about it at every possible opportunity. Now, that car is a very sophisticated piece of engineering from an almost brand new company. How is it possible that that product has become so mature in such a short time? The answer is because actually a lot of the technology comes from their competitors. And like any other sensible automobile manufacturer, Tesla works with its competitors and they exchange knowledge and they exchange technology. And I would like to see a revolution of co-optition at the level of governments. Because on the rare occasions I've been able to encourage it and stimulate it myself, I've seen it work marvels. And that's what I would like to see. We can work together, and we can still compete. But the competition analogy, the sporting analogy, is a really important one. Life on Earth is not a sprint to the finish. It's not about who gets there first. It's a team sport. So we can still be competitive and collaborative at the same time, and we can all win if only we could get out of this trap of believing that nation states have to be warring tribes, because that's what's killing us, and that's what's making the gigantic global challenges get worse and worse and worse instead of better and better and better.
Your day job brings you into contact with heads of states, leaders across the planet. Out of everybody that you haven't met so far, who would you like to meet, and what question would you like to ask them?
Donald Trump, no question. He's the man I most want to meet on the planet right now.
And what would you like to ask him?
I don't know what I'd like to ask him. I'd like to have a conversation with him about America First, because it seems to me that when he preaches America First, he's doing what a good president should do. He's promising to as much of his population as he can reach that he's going to take their needs very seriously. And that's what a head of state, a head of government should do. But there's something about the tone of that America First, which seems to imply that if America is first, nobody else can be. Everybody else has to be somewhere between second and last. And I honestly believe that if we accept that, we're doomed. So the conversation I would love to have with Donald Trump, because I think that it would be a fascinating conversation, is can we together imagine a scenario where everybody could be first? And what could America do to help that happen? The interesting thing is that his stance prior to the election made it look very much as if he wanted everybody else to be last. But his behavior, and particularly the behavior of Rex Tillerson and his government since then, has appeared to be more accepting of the idea that you do have to work with not only your allies, but also to some extent with your competitors and even your antagonists. And so I'm relieved to see that. I'm relieved to see that there's a lot of, whoever it was, Churchill said, jaw, rather than war. But I would love to have that conversation with him, because he's the man whose views on this matter most at this point in history.
Simon Anholt, founder of Good Country, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Andrea.